Hey there, my name is Magix and welcome back to my next Let's Play series of this time Might and Magic 7 for Blood and Honor. Just a couple of months ago we played the part 6 of the series and I have this urge that I want to play the part 7 again. And yeah, just like we did it in the 6th part, I used the Greyface patch 2.4. So the latest patch there is, I think it's even from 2019, so pretty fresh. And yeah, there will be no suicide dives or enchantment hex to make infinite money or something like that. Just a straight playthrough, and I will show you how I did it the last time. I think I've made a pretty overpowered party on the Dark Path, and after we do that, and you know the basic game, I actually want to install a modification to this game and want to play it new, and then we can see what really changes and how the game mechanics changed. And it will be the first time I play this modification too, so it might be just a whole new adventure. I'm eager to see how this will play out, but for now we will just play the basic game so you can also see the maybe improvements they made from the 6th part, but maybe also there are changes you don't like. And yeah, I have played this game a lot when I was younger, so I think I know most things in and out. it is also not that difficult compared to the 6th part, because this game doesn't throw hordes of monsters at you at all time. There are not that many monsters that have ranged attacks, so the beginning is still maybe a little bit of a challenge. Maybe not the first tutorial island, but the beginning afterwards. But if you know what you are doing, you can get your way around, again, starting with a bow and stuff, right? That's about a good idea always, and go from there. The healing magic in this part of the series is far stronger, but what is more interesting is that you have to decide if you want to grab light or dark magic, and from there on the game becomes a little bit different depending on what you choose. If you remember from the 6th path, you could learn both schools of magic at the same time, and if a character could learn the skills, usually they were able to master them. This is not the case anymore in this part of the series. If you choose a skill, or if you can grab a skill, it doesn't mean that you can automatically master it to the highest degree. And if you say go for the dark path, you won't have all the strong buff magic, because that is now stuffed into the light magic part, and then you actually are incentivized to go for fire, air, water, or earth, and or earth magic, because they have still buffs in this school, and bringing up those magic schools has then some merit, because you get the stronger versions of the buffs, right? Whereas in Might and Magic 6 you just go for light and dark magic, because all the buffs are literally in there, and you don't have to waste any more points than grabbing, let's say, town portal in water and fly in air. Because also the strongest attacking magic was in dark, so there was no really incentives to go into the elemental schools, but they changed it in 7, which I actually like. But yeah, let's enjoy the intro, and then we meet again for the character creation, because there are also some parts that they changed and added. So, see you back in a second.
Push the goddamn button!
You heard what she said.
Master Iron Fist, Lieutenant Kalik and Sergeant Piridak reporting.
Proceed.
While dutifully patrolling the beach at Brighton Point as ordered, we detected a large raiding party of 40 elves invading our territory. When the time was right, we attacked.
Oh, how brave.
The enemy fell back before the fury of our attack. We accepted our duty to defend our fair land. We killed at least half a dozen of them before they knew what was happening. The rest ran like pigs from an axe. We gave chase, and I saw with my... What is so amusing, Master?
Nothing. Continue.
Of course. As I was saying, we were chasing the goblins, shooting them in the backs because they would not stand and fight honorably.
Regrettable, but necessary.
Yes, Your Majesty. We had slain nearly all of the goblins when we saw the sea monsters approaching. At first, we thought they had come to help the goblins, but it soon became clear their arrival had nothing to do with the fight on the beach. We ran for cover in the rocks. Each was carrying a bag around his waist, and each was wearing a curious amulet that looked like a small black box.
What? Wait a minute. Go back.
You mean the part where I personally slew two elves with a single arrow?
No, no! After that lie! Tell me about the boxes!
They were about an inch and a half on the side, and made of smooth black metal. We couldn't get a closer look.
Those boxes sound like something out of legend. What happened next?
The sea people began to quarrel, when one group turned abruptly and started walking away down the beach. The remaining started walking the other way. In the morning, we found that one of them had shed its skin on the beach. Their tracks had washed away in the tide, so we decided to return to base and report.
Thank you for your report, Lieutenant Kalik. I am pleased to hear something interesting for once. You are promoted to captain. Assemble a search party at once and find those sea people. If you succeed, you can keep the promotion, as well as your life. Oh, and Kalik, one more thing.
Good luck.
Hey there, my name is Magix, and welcome back to the next Let's Play of, Might and Magic 7. I decided that I want to play this game again, and let's just jump into the character creation, right? Let's go! Okay, guys, welcome back to the create party of this game. It looks kind of the same as in Might and Magic 6, right? The attributes are all the same. You have certain breakpoints to each attribute where you get additional bonis, advantages if you reach a certain threshold. Let's say if you have might of 12, you get a minus 1 attack bonus. If you are at 14, it's a neutral of 0, and as soon as you reach a green mark, you get a bonification of plus 1. But then the next threshold is, I think, at 30. Then the next goes at 50, and then 100, and stuff like that, so that you won't get massive amounts of plus attack bonuses when you reach levels of 150. And if you choose the light path with Day of the Gods, that gives you huge attribute bonuses, then it doesn't matter that much anymore if you reach 150 or 200 at this point. It's just icing on the cake. So that's also why I like usually the dark path a little bit more, but there are certain so-called challenges thrown around the map that check your attributes, and if you have a certain threshold of the attribute, let's say 100, 150, or 200, you get bonus skill points. So you can still get them easily with Day of the Gods, though it doesn't really matter in the grand scheme of of things, in my opinion. Now, you can also see that we have different races in this part of the game, whereas in Might and Magic 6 we only had the human race. And Goblin race is more for the melee brute force classes. You can see that, for example, we have 8 bonus points right now, and with a single bonus with a single point, I get +2 on might, because goblins focus on the might part. So if you make a knight, right, a melee class, then picking a goblin is advantage is an advantage. Whereas if you want to boost his intellect, well, you can see that you have to spend 2 points to get 1 point in here. So the opposite of the goblin would be the elf. So the goblin is probably the best race for the knight, whereas the elf is the best race for the sorcerer, because if you want high intelligence, you can see for a single bonus point you get +2 in intellect. Now, as I mentioned, it's only really somewhat useful in the beginning of the game, because as soon as you are beyond 30 or 50, it takes so much points to get additional benefits out of these attributes. So you could make a goblin sorcerer out of the fun for it. It doesn't really matter. The human is the most neutral. I think you can spend any one bonus point for one attribute bonus, so that's the most balanced race. And I think dwarves are somewhat in between. I think their accuracy or endurance, yeah, endurance was their biggest sell. I guess accuracy was also for the elves, exactly. So elves could also be a good archer, and speed was also for the goblins here. That's mostly it. Personality, so I think it's not for the dwarf. Also not. It's also not for the human. It doesn't matter really.
Pick me.
What I will do now is delete all this progress in here. I don't want to use a preset party. And I will be boring and just choose humans again. And we want a dangerous looking human knight.
Choose me.
I don't is the most.
I'm your pick me. I'm your.
Choose me.
Most dangerous looking. I think this guy. And as a homage to our party from Might and Magic 6, you will be Conan again. You are reborn in this part of the series, and you will be our Knight Berserker. And yeah, the classes are mostly the same, you know, from the last part. They added 3 more classes, though I don't think that they are that good. As in the last part, we have the Knight. The Knight is your standard melee class that can learn all the weapon types and usually bring it up to Grandmaster. Right, you can see here if you use a right click on the skill. If everything is white, then you can learn it from the start. Yellow means you can learn it but need a promotion to your starting class. I think Knight can become Cavalier and then Champion or something like that. I also quickly delete these extra skills here, and if we go to our knight, you can see he can, for example, Grandmaster the Sword. Grandmaster is a new skill rank after Master. This is also added in 7, and each class has a specific set of skills that it can Grandmaster. A class cannot anymore master any skill. You can see that while the knight can learn or starts with leather, it can't reach the Grandmaster of leather, because the game kind of wants your knight to pick up plate armor later on, and he is actually the only class that can Grandmaster the plate armor. Now, in my opinion, it's not that important for the weapon types, because as you can see again, Swordmaster allows you to dual wield, and like in Magic 6, if you combine that, for example, with a spear, the spear also allows you to dual wield, so you can wear a spear and a sword. You get both bonuses of each weapon type for your damage and for your attack bonus, and thus it's the strongest weapon combination. And if you could reach Grandmaster, fine, you get some bonus armor class from your spear and sword, kind of to replace a shield. But if you wouldn't get the armor class, in my opinion, it's still fine. You can do without it. Now, if you compare this to a Paladin, which is another melee class that we have used in Might and Magic 6, the only difference is in Might and Magic 6, the difference was, okay, the Paladin has a mana bar and could use some self-magic. And here he could also master the self-magic, so you could say that the Paladin was more useful than the Knight. Yes, the Knight had more HP, but since the Paladin could revive or heal status ailments and stuff like that, he was a little bit more useful. Now, in this part of the game, if we pick a sword, well, you can still dual wield, but you can see that he can't Grandmaster all this stuff again. So you are really limited to mace and sword, so to say, to deal comparable damage to a knight. But now there is also a new skill called Arms Master, and this is the strongest skill a melee class can pick up. Because if you just read what this skill does, it adds bonuses to your attack and your recovery time, so it also increases your weapon speed. And the Grandmaster level of this skill allows you to double all the previous bonuses, so this is the skill to aim for after you reach the ability to dual wield. And if we compare that with a Knight, well, the Knight is the only class, or one of the only class, to get a Grandmaster in it. And so, in my opinion, since the Paladin can't reach Grandmaster in these self-magics anymore, in my opinion, this class is useless. If you run the Cleric, that can't get Grandmaster in all these self-magic schools. Because the Cleric, again, can also master the mace. Doesn't really matter if you can paralyze an opponent or not. Yes, the Cleric can't dual wield, but you don't need to, because he or she can pick up light or dark magic and use this as source of damage, so no big deal there. And that's why I think that Paladin in this part is not a good class. Cleric is the only class now that can really get the Grandmaster of the Self Schools, and body magic is so strong in this part of the game, where if you compare it to Might and Magic 6, where we need like 5 to 6 power cures to heal our party somewhat good, that is not the case in Might and Magic 7. If you put the points into body magic and use a power cure, you can really see the effect. You don't need as much healing magic anymore. And there's also a new skill called Regeneration, which heals your HP over time. And with the Grandmaster, you have a really high rate of healing, or a passive healing, so that also kind of offsets most damage that's incoming if you combine that with your power cure, so you don't need as much healers in your party anymore compared to part 6. That's why I never really picked a Paladin in this game, if I don't want to use a fun run or make the game a little bit more harder and limit my ability to Grandmaster body magic. Now, Grandmaster body magic really breaks the game. It makes the game far more easier, so I'm not sure I will use it all the time. But maybe I will, because I want to show you the effects of it. And then after we install the modification and restart the game, I want to see if this is still the case or not. Okay, what else do we have? The Archer in part 6 was a mix between Knight and Sorcerer. It's the same case in this part of this series, though it's the only class that can get a Grandmaster level of the bow. And with this, you can actually out-damage blaster cannons in the late game if you find the good bow. But at this stage of the game, you don't really need a bow anymore, because we do most of the times the same thing we do in Might and Magic 6. We put on a haste buff, get our melee guys in front of the enemies, and with Grandmaster and Arms Master, we just melt through the hordes of enemies. So the damage output is far higher in melee or with spells than the bow can provide. And he can only get the elemental skills to master. Again, Grandmaster is not limited for a hybrid class. It's only for the pure class. So the Sorcerer is the only that can get Grandmaster in the magic schools again, and That's why I think Archer is also not the best class, because he can only get Expert and Master rank after the first promotion, not even in the beginning. You probably won't spend any points in the beginning here anyways, and if we then look at the miscellaneous skills, Perception, yes, he can get to Grandmaster, but usually you don't need 100% success rate for this. You will find rings that buff the skill, and with the Master degree, a triple effect of skill, if you have like a plus 15 ring, which is not uncommon if you get a Grandmaster water for the enchantment stuff, then you have a skill ranking of, let's say, 21, triples 3. It's so high, you will reach nearly 100% success anyways. And if you played the game a couple of times, there's no need for perception anymore. So, Arms Master, again, he can only get to expert. Learning doesn't really matter, and that's about it. So, if we compare that to a knight, let's say we would give him the perception. It's only expert, but it's enough for me. I mean, I know the game a little bit, and maybe I miss it here or there, so a red dot on a hidden button could be helpful, but it's worth notable that the knight is the only class that can get repair up to a maximum level, I think, alongside the paladin. Here it's repair item. Again, you don't nearly reach Grandmaster, but it's one of the most useful miscellaneous skills, because the enemies in the late game will again break a lot of your equipment, trying to weaken you that way, so you need at least one character that can repair, and the Archer can't fulfill that role. Another good skill is Merchant, but that is already for the Cleric. Because with Grandmaster you can buy and sell items at cost, so you can pretty easily get infinite money with this. With the merchant skill, you just buy, that is what I meant in the beginning, you buy the item from the shop for its lowest price, put an enchantment on it and sell it back for a high price, and you can do this with all the shops in the game and have literally infinite money then. So, yeah. The only thing the Archer really provides is this bow skill at Grandmaster, and in my opinion, by the point you get this, you don't really need it anymore, so I also don't like this class in the basic version of the game. Then we have the Ranger class, with which is, in my opinion, the weakest of all, because he can't get Grandmaster in any skill besides the axe, and I think Identify Monster, exactly. Where in Might and Magic 6 I have always put pictures into the game to show you the monster statistics, they actually put a skill in this part of the game that allows you to see all these statistics with this Identify Monster skill. And I think I will use this simply to show you the enemies without putting pictures in all times in the game. But picking the Ranger class just to identify monster resistances, if we compare this to the... Oh, okay, that's something I forgot. I thought the Sorcerer could only get Master, but since the Sorcerer can also get this to Grandmaster, I mean, it costs around 10 skill points, so you could ease that up a little bit, since the Sorcerer has now a lot of reasons to buff up the elemental skills. You need a lot of skill points if you only run one Sorcerer. But I wouldn't pick a Ranger just for this skill, because... Well, if you're really interested, you can always use Google and forgo this skill. And X is the only other skill he really can get to Grandmaster. He can learn, I think, everything and can get expert in most of the things, but he can't master anything, and the game really rewards you for getting Grandmaster ranks, so it's like the guy that can do everything but nothing really good, so eh. Then we have the Thief class, which is actually useful. It can get a Grandmaster in Dagger, and if you dual wield daggers, you can see that you have a chance to do triple damage, and you have two daggers, so both get these bonus, and daggers are pretty fast, so thieves can deal a lot of damage, especially if you find the good daggers, and I think compared to the Knight, they are not that far behind on the HP pool. And it's the only class that can get a Grandmaster rank in Disarm Trap, and Disarm Trap is actually a pretty useful skill. Also because you can reach the Master level without any promotion, so you can just go in the beginning directly to the Master rank, and there are a few dungeons, if I remember correctly, that have pretty good loot, but pretty heavily trapped chests, and it's easily done to go to these places earlier on, because there are only melee monsters, and I think you can kite them with a little bit hit and run, and then you can get these high level chests early on. And this is something the Thieves allows you with the Disarm Trap, whereas other classes can't reach the Master level that fast, and your party probably blows up then in this place. And that is mostly the reason to pick a Thief, actually. So you have a little weaker Knight, but a pretty strong Disarmor. That is really not bad, so I like the Thief class. And yeah, we have the Druid again, which is a mix of Cleric and Sorcerer. It's actually, on the HP pool, the weakest class, but you can learn Self and Elemental Magic, and you can get all these Self and Elemental skills to the Master rank, but you can't reach Grandmaster with the Druid, and Druids can't learn Light and Dark Magic. And that is a huge, huge problem for this class. There are schools where the Grandmaster skill is not that important, definitely not. It's viable if you just go for the Master rank. What the Druid provides for your group is actually Alchemy. This is another new skill. You remember that we could mix potions freely in Might and Magic 6 if we just put the right color combinations together, and then you could make black potions with permanent attribute buffs right in the beginning. Not the case anymore in 7. I'm glad that they removed this. You now have a skill that you need to make better potions, and the skill also allows you to make stronger potions. Like in 6, the healing potion or mana potion was just always 10 points. You couldn't really affect this. Or at least I don't know a way to affect this or make this stronger. Whereas alchemy, each point into alchemy adds a value to the base level of the potion. So with the Grandmaster rank, you can make stronger healing potions. And there are also various ingredients. Like there are not anymore only berries you can put into a potion to make a red potion. There are now also like dragon blood, and dragon blood has then a base value of 150 or 50, and then your alchemy skill gets on top, so the druid allows you to make pretty strong healing potions and buff potions even, and he is the only class that allows you to make black potions, and because you can't make black potions anymore in the beginning, you need the Grandmaster rank. They improved the value from 25 or 15 with minus 5 to another attribute to just straight plus 50 to a single attribute with no downside. So as soon as you reach the Grandmaster skill, your whole party can get a plus 50 to all attributes. Now, as I mentioned in the beginning, attributes won't matter at a specific height, so while it sounds nice, it's not that important. Yes, there are also some other some other black potions that are good, not only attribute ones. There are also some that can heal magical aging and stuff like that. But the high-level villages in the town, or the villages in the later areas of the game, occasionally also sell these black potions, so if you spend a lot of time in the game, you can buy the stuff or find the stuff in chests eventually. It's unlikely that you will find 3, 6, 7 times 4 black different potions to each attribute for each class, but then again, You don't need personality for your sorcerer. It's kind of useless because the sorcerer doesn't get any bonus points if you improve the personality stat, so it's not actually 28 in total. Now, since you don't need a Grandmaster rank in all schools of magic, because not all Grandmaster skills are that great, the Druid helps your party to save a few skill points here and there and put it into his skill build, so it can help all around, but it's only usually you really only pick him for the alchemy, and sorcerer can get alchemy to master, which is enough for the buff potions and to make good healing potions for your mana pool and HP pool. So I don't have really a reason to run a druid over a second sorcerer, in my opinion, because the sorcerer can get grandmaster rank in all elemental schools, thus he gets Lloyd's Beacon and pretty strong offensive spells like Starburst. He can learn light or dark magic, put it up to grandmaster 2, and with two sorcerers you also get the benefit of distributing your points. So let's say sorcerer A can focus on earth and fire, and sorcerer B can more use the non-combat spells like Town Portal or Lloyd's Beacon in water, or fly and invisible in air, and then both can spend their points equally in dark magic, so you have a pretty offensive possibilities then, and I don't see that much of a reason to run a druid, only if you want to make the game harder and forgo the grandmaster skills, of course. And then for the last class, there is the monk class, and the monk class is a new unique class. You can see that there are also two new skills called dodging and unarmed, or I think there was an unarmed skill in 6.2, but it was kind of useless. Unarmed gives you attack and damage bonuses if you don't wear a weapon, like the skill name says. And dodging allows you, just increases your armor class if you don't wear an armor. Now, what's special about the monk is that he can get a grandmaster rank in both of these. So it's not only there if your armor gets broken and you don't have a guy that can't repair your stuff, because that is unusual. These two skills that only the monk can grandmaster allow him then to, for example, an example of dodging, to use leather armor at grandmaster. So you also get then the benefits of leather and can increase your armor class even more. And with unarmed, you also can with the stuff. Don't know why it says here that the chance to await an incoming attack is equal to the skill. Let me quickly compare. Oh, it was the other way around. So if you grandmaster the stuff, you are able to use the stuff in combination with unarmed. So you get all the bonuses of unarmed, plus the offensive possibilities of a staff. So you can combine both of these and then get kind of an equal damage output to a knight. Now you would think, what other things brings the monk to the table? Well, he can also learn self-magic, just like the paladin. So later on he can also go for body magic and spirit magic, so you have a not bodybuilding, it's not in the starting skills, but he can learn self-magic. He has a mana pool if you get the first promotion. So you can also use him as a debuffer, kind of like the paladin, or as a buffer. And then he also has the disarm skill. That's also not in the starting tree, but he can learn it. And on the dark path, he can actually get this to master. Now, master unarming disarming means you get triple the bonus. So if you have, again, a plus 15 disarm or something like that, usually it's enough to open any chest in the game. So you can forgo a thief if you choose the monk. The monk has a higher damage output as soon as you hit the grandmaster ranks. He also gets a benefit from a buff in the body school, where you get even further damage bonuses if you don't wear a weapon or a bonus to your unarmed skill. And then you also have a guy that can pick up items that have bonuses to unarmed, because else usually you would sell them because no one else has really use for it. It's the only class that can get the Grandmaster rank in bodybuilding, so you quintuple your HP pool, kind of. And that allows you that the spell Shared Life, that adds all the HP points of each character together and distributes the total sum evenly, making it an instant heal for the whole party, kind of. And last but not least, he can also get a Master rank in Arms Master, whereas the Paladin could only reach Expert. So if you want to kind of run a Paladin, in my opinion, run a Monk. Doesn't matter that he can only run leather, because you get the bonuses of all the dodging stuff, and you can see that with the triple effect on 10, it's like plus 30 armor class in combination with the highest leather. I think it's around plate armor easily, because also you at master leather you get double the armor class points in here too, so plus 14 already, because master is always at skill level 7. And because he has more useful skills like the disarm trap, I think the perception, no, it was not. Yeah, but disarm trap is huge, so if you don't run a thief and want a monk for a change, I think monk is definitely viable. He brings a lot to the table. That's why I want to run a monk in this playthrough.
Come on.
Hey, please.
Come on.
Please.
How about me?
Pick me.
Do we choose a dwarf monk?
How about me?
Please choose me.
Come on.
Yeah, why not? This old guy seems like a pretty destructive fist fighter. And I think there are also some items that can only be worn by male characters, some only by female characters. And some can only be worn by, yeah, each specific race. So I'm not sure if I want a draw.
I'm your man.
Can't remember.
I'm your man.
Please.
Sally, you want to ride high?
If I know that there are specific gloves with the unarmed skill, but I'm not sure if they're race dependent. Maybe. So a human monk. Yeah, let's call him Leo. Seems about right. And
pick me.
What voice do we give him?
I'm your man.
You need a strong warrior like myself.
I'm your man.
Yeah, he is our man. Okay.
You want to ride high?
Sally ho! I'm your man.
Please
pick me.
Pick me.
How about me?
Want a scruffy, badass voice for Conan?
Right here.
Pick me.
Choose me.
I'm your man.
Pick me.
Choose me.
I am the one you need.
Come on, pick me.
Pick me.
Come on, pick me.
Right here.
How about me?
I won't let you down.
Come on.
Hey, right here, Chief.
How about me?
Right here.
Pick me.
Right here.
Come on, pick me.
Pick me.
Choose me.
I'm your man.
Sally ho.
Choose me.
Please.
Come on, pick.
Pick me.
How about me?
I won't let you down.
How about me?
I won't let you down.
Pick me.
You need a strong warrior like myself.
Yeah, that is the voice. That's what I was searching for.
Please
pick
okay.
me.
You need
you.
You wanna ride?
No, I'm a racist, so we stay with the human race.
What could go wrong?
Think.
Pick me
for
pick me.
Come on, pick me.
Pick choose me. What could go wrong?
Let's choose her for the cleric.
Pick me.
I'm the one you want.
Don't get me killed. What could go wrong?
Pick me for your party.
Pick me.
I want a soft voice for her.
I want in!
Nope.
Please choose me.
Don't leave home without me.
That sounds funny.
Pick me. I'll be helpful.
You have to choose me.
That's a goblin's voice.
Pick me. I'll be helpful.
Pick me. Pick me.
Take me.
I want in!
Take me.
Pick me. Pick
take me.
I
choose me.
Pick me for your party.
Pick me.
That sounds nice. Okay, what name do we give our cleric then? The last part, I can't even remember what names I used. It feels so stupid. I need a neutral name, because if we choose a dark path, I can't use a heavenly name or something like that. Let's call her Harmony, so she can either be the Harmony of Life or the Harmony of Death. Cheesy, but that's it.
Please, choose me.
How about me?
Take me.
Oh, come pick me!
Take me.
Then we take Sorceress.
Pick me.
Pick, please, pick me.
Pick me. Pick me.
Take me.
Oh, come on. Pick me.
Choose me.
Oh, come on. Pick me.
Take me.
Let's just go with this. Faith. Faith. We need. Let's use a Final Fantasy name. Let's see. So she will bring death and destruction to the world. Now to the attribute points. Like in the last game, the knight doesn't need any intellect, he doesn't need any personality, he doesn't need any luck to be specific. No one needs luck really. Luck is only there to maybe avoid a trap or to avoid a negative magic spell. Might, I think, was also for the monk. He doesn't need intellect, if I remember correctly. It's only for sorcerer, archer, ranger, thief, and druid, so you can be stupid. But personality was for monks. Not sure he needs it right in the beginning, because he can't learn the spell since the first promotion. Cleric doesn't need to be intelligent, need her personality, and sorcerer doesn't need the personality, and doesn't need might. Also don't need might. That's about right. Now we buff up might to the first threshold for our melee chars. And the same can be said for intellects, but since we have so high bonus points, you can get it to 30. You can get yours to 20. And then I actually want to go for accuracy evenly. Sorcerer has a bonus on accuracy because it's an elf, but as the might's stat is really low, I don't think we'll go that much higher. Maybe like this. So, yeah, maybe let's stay at neutral. Then we can spend some points on the endurance. Oh, elves are not that endurant. So, let's. Can't get a might point here anymore. So let's spend it on personality here. Okay. There are certainly more optimal ways to spend the attributes than I did, but I think it's fine. Now for the starting skills. Human Knight, you start with Thought and Leather. I'd like to pick up some useful skills. Perception is not one of them. Don't think we will ever go shield for you. You can get Grandmaster Shield, but you will be our melee destructive force, so kind of also want to give him spear, so we have some options in finding either a good spear or a good sword. And maybe even the Arms Master skill, just so he can attack a little bit faster. Then for the monk, in the beginning you focus on unarmed and dodging, or you forgo dodging and go for leather actually, because you think you need master to actually outclass the leather armor, and then with Grandmaster you can pick your leather back up, so I think leather is a little bit more valuable in the beginning. Disarming is not here, but I will definitely pick it up and bring it up to expert as soon as possible. Don't need identify monster. So all the weapons are kind of useless. So let's also go with Arms Master. And I definitely want a merchant in the beginning, and I think spirit magic is still important for the bless spell. And we will pick mind up later. Our knight will also learn repair SAP. And for our sorceress, definitely water and air magic. We will grab these identify skills later on, and maybe even alchemy, though I'm not sure I will use this, because we can buy potions in shops, so we have some use for the shops, because I think in the last part we never really bought any other items than our starting bows. And that's about it. Conan, our barbarian knight. Leo, our monk. Harmony, our cleric. And Genova, our sorceress. And only non-human in the group. But it won't matter, because if I choose the dark path, she will die anyways and become a lich. So, yep, pretty straightforward. And here we go.
Hear ye, hear ye. The Emerald Island scavenger hunt is about to begin. The list of objects has been given to all contestants. As you know, the winners of the contest will be awarded title to Castle Harmony and the surrounding lands. Be careful. Emerald Island can be dangerous. Last night, three contestants disappeared, and we are concerned for their safety. During the contest, please be on the lookout for our missing contestants. If you find a piece of equipment in the woods, return at once with a clue. It may save their lives. There have been rumors that some kind of monster is loose on the island and may be hiding in one of the caves. If you see a cave you are unfamiliar with, don't go into it. Send someone back to town and the guards will conduct a search for you. We don't want anyone else to get hurt. And one more thing. We have reports that the monster may be a dragon. If you see it, run for your lives.
So, welcome to Emerald Island. This is more like a tutorial island that is there to... kind of make you comfortable with the game, show you the mechanics, how it works. Welcome to Emerald Isle. I will be your guide during your stay here. From time to time I will appear to tell you blah blah blah. She tells you all about this tutorial stuff. I will turn the tour off because I will be your tour guide. And just in like part 6 you can have NPCs traveling with your party. They can bring different bonuses to your group, like a locksmith I think helps you to improve your disarm skill, and 6 points is a lot, and it's pretty useful in the beginning because we don't have a thief but only Leo the monk. So I actually wanted to hire him, but he needs 300 gold and we only have 200. So I hope he will be there if I reload the game. And here, if you see a campfire, usually there's food in there. Our food is here, and you need food if you travel by foot or if you want to rest. Resting allows you to heal up, but only in green areas. If the light here is not green but yellow, then that means enemies are near and you usually can't rest. And if the light is red, then there are enemies certainly around you, and you have usually to fight. The rest option is here. Resting takes also 8 hours of game time, right? And you need 2 food to rest here. If you rest on a green area, then you only need one apple or one food ration, and I think desert and snow areas or swamp areas take even more than the dirt and green ones. Our spellbook, well, it's there, but you only have a few starting spells, like detect life, so we can see the opponent's life points. That's what I meant, you don't need to search up the monster statistics anymore. You can use spells now to do this, or a skill, if you want to see resistances and abilities of the opponents. And then we just start with some basic skills like Torchlight, Wizard's Eye. Wizard's Eye is actually one of the most useful starting spells alongside Torchlight. Torchlight makes dark areas more bright, and Wizard's Eye allows you to activate this minimap kind of a little bit more. Just let me show you. Now you can see green dots, which are friendly NPCs, and yellow dots would be dead NPCs, and red ones would be opponents. And if we rank up the Wizard's Eye, you can also see loot in blue. So it's one of the most useful spells. You can now see an eye here dingling around. That means the buff is on. You can see a torch to the right, which indicates the torchlight buff. Just for showing you, right now there is a torch too. In the left upper corner, you can also see how long it's active and all the resistance buffs. Fire, wind, water, earth, and I think mind and body, because there are some harmful body spells too. And on the right part, there are buffs like heroism that boosts your attack bonus, haste that improves your speed, shield to reduce missile damage, stone skin that improves armor class. There's also a new buff spell called immolation that puts a flame aura around your party, and whenever a monster gets near, he will get flame damage. If you remember the Ooses in Might and Magic 6 that were immune to physical damage, well, this emulation is one way to fight through that without spamming your entire mana pool at the opponent. And they added in the Fire School a beginner spell that allows you to put a fire buff on your item, so you can deal at least 1 or 2 points of fire damage in addition to the damage the weapon provides. And this allows you to fight the slimes also in the beginning without running away necessarily. Then Day of the Gods, and the last one is Protection from Magic, which now, like the name implies, really protects you from magic. It prevents debuffs, and if you get a Grandmaster rank in it, it can also prevent the instant death skills some opponents are using. Then we just have our game options menu, save game, load game, right, stuff like that, and here our current quests and some notes. For all the alchemy receipts, if you create a potion, you get a note how to do it again. The obelisks are back in this part too, and some other notes like a red barrel would increase your strength or something like that. And that is about it for the menu, and let's end the episode here. That was the introduction and the party creation, and in the next part we will clear out this tutorial island. So stay tuned, have a great day, and till next time, bye bye.